This is Hacking the Afterlife Podcast with Jennifer Shaffer.
Hello, Jennifer.
Hi, Richard. How are you?
I am completely discombobulated. I don't know why. But, you know, sometimes things happen and you're like, what is going on with my world today?
That's a lot. Well, I still don't feel like I'm back yet. I'm still in that ether.
You're still in Mexico? Some part of you is...
Yeah. So I went to go see Dr. Joe Dispenza.
Yeah. How was that?
It was truly beautiful. We meditated for hours, like lectures and then meditation and more lectures, but it's 2,000 people at once.
Everything
that you've always said, like the neuroplasticity in your brain, epigenetics, you can change your brain, right?
Yeah. I do recommend that meditation stuff. The epigenetics is a little different scientific thing about DNA and genetic, you know.
But if they've also done studies based upon taking, you know, very astute meditators, taking their blood and putting it next to cancer cells and how they don't multiply. They've done studies on it. They've documented it.
Okay, that's very cool. No, I haven't seen that stuff. That's great, though. I totally dig that you went there. 2,000 people, it's amazing.
1,000 people, and I got to meet him and talk to him. Of course, he wants to study my brain because I'm in gamma all the time. Like, my heart rate doesn't move. And they were watching it. It does not move at all. Here I think I'm making my heart rate go up for the breathing.
Okay. That's interesting. Well, I got to say, at the University of Pennsylvania, there's somebody who's been doing studies with mediums. They bring them in and they do MRI studies. And that is a field that people are into. Also to see, you know, we talk about the filters on the brain and the question becomes, how do we let them go or lower them? Or, you know, why is it that Jennifer has different filters than someone else? And I know we spoke to your dad on the flip side about that. And he told us a little bit about, you know, he kind of showed us how he first became aware that you had like a different way of communicating, but as well as, you know, and
that was the best part. I spent the whole week with my dad.
Oh, that's so cool.
I didn't, you know, I had to unlearn. People went there to get into the place that I'm at all the time, right? In that gamma state. I went there. I had to unlearn instead of like trying to get information or trying to focus it or any of that. I had to really, really step back and allow. I had to do the opposite. And we did a walking meditation before we went in to do some healing, where we focused in on somebody that was in front of us. And during that walking meditation, every single person from our class came through, from Steve Jobs to Kobe Bryant, who put Jessica Alba, you know, she won't mind me saying this, Jessica Alba, she's one of the main reasons we were able to we went together, and two other girls, girlfriends of ours, and she knew Kobe Bryant. And so he popped into my head, tell Jessica I'm here for her. Like she, you know, which was very sweet because he also popped into her head because she's more open now to all this. And so I was just basically reconfirming what was happening with her. But it was truly one of like my biggest thing was getting my heart open. Cause I asked my heart, I'm like, what is it that, you know, what is it that my heart needs? And I got my heart being really small. I'm going to cry. And I'm like, why? What do you mean? I'm like, I have the biggest heart. I'm like, what are you talking about? My heart's so small. And then I got this huge wall around it. And I sat there, I'm like, why? And I was being shown my cases. I've cut myself off to feel so I can do the work that I'm doing.
The work, yeah.
And that it was okay to open up my heart, do my work, but maybe cry afterwards, but not keep myself completely closed. Because the only way that my heart's going to grow or get more full is by allowing it to happen and taking the risk of being uncomfortable, you know, that I don't have to do that all the time with my work.
Yeah, and we've talked about that quite a bit, mainly because of, you know, about 30% of your work is with law enforcement, and people, they don't call you because they're having a great time. They call you because something traumatic has happened and they put you in that space. It's literally like saying, would you step into the car that I'm driving that's going 200 miles an hour around a track and tell me what's going on? And you have to experience that. So it's very difficult for a medium like you to deal with that.
Yeah, and I was told it was okay to have my heart a little bit closed, but to realize to open it up during the other times versus keeping it sheltered the whole time.
Yeah.
It's okay to feel into things. It was interesting. And I do feel like my brain has changed and I am meditating every morning.
Well, that's fabulous. I got to mention, I had a dream last night. Like, it just popped into my head. And at the end of the dream, I was playing piano in a nightclub somewhere. And I was there saying, and the owner of the club was saying, okay, we're closing up now. You know, I think you're not going to be invited back. Your gig is over. And I was like, well, I had all these people here. And then I started to wake up, and the actor who was playing the role of the bar owner, I said, so why is it that it ended this way? And she said, well, you told me that you wanted me to not hire you in this dream. So that's why it ended that way. It was like she was playing an actress in the dream that I had created. Anyway, so it is mind-bending. I do want to ask Luana if she has anyone standing by to talk to us. I did want to invite a couple of people today, which we normally don't do, but I want to see if she has brought them forward. And Luana's our friend on the flip side who does what Jennifer does, but over on the flip side for people in our, what we call, class.
Right. Who,
can I say their names, their first names?
Give me their first names.
So I'm going to ask for a guy named Norman.
Okay.
And a guy named Lenny.
Okay. I don't know either one of them, so this is good.
Okay. And Luana, do they want to come forward and talk to us?
Norman feels like he's too busy smoking.
He's too busy smoking. Okay, that's good.
Lenny is a spaz. Lenny feels like a spaz to me. Like, he feels like he's all over the place mentally. So I don't know if he's a scientist or does he study the brain or something, but he's just like all over the place.
He's all over the place. Well, who wants to, we'll identify them as we go forward.
The director.
Sorry?
Which one? One feels like a researcher or a director.
Norman's the guy that's more involved with the creation of like a director, let's say, more like a.
And Lenny is, there's something with music. So
absolutely. Lenny is involved with music.
Okay. He said I was involved with music. I don't know why I still don't trust.
Okay, very good. And Lenny, so which one of you guys wants to talk first? I'm sorry to put it this way.
And when people, I'm just so you know,
this is you got Norman and Lenny. I got to say, I had a conversation in my head with Norman, who immediately said, oh, we have mutual friends and I'm ready to talk to you. This was when a couple of weeks ago. And Lenny is somebody that I'm just dying to talk to.
I have to say this because who's the guy that I keep forgetting that is your Bill Paxton? Why do I forget his name?
Well, I don't know. That's good because Bill is an old pal and he likes to show up. What is
he showed me the Titanic. He was showing me the Titanic. So
that's his reference for Jennifer. Mm-hmm. She first met him when he showed her the Titanic.
He's loud. He's like, you're the Titanic. Okay.
Crash.
Bill, I'll never forget your name now. Okay.
All right. So Billy, who should I talk to first? Norman or Lenny?
Lenny.
Lenny. Okay. Very good. Lenny, please.
Only because it's taking a little bit. Is Norman new to the other
yes,
side?
Yes, both of them. Well, no, I'm sorry. Norman is new. Lenny is not.
This is why they said this. They said, take Lenny first because Norman is still getting used to everything. And so that's why I asked the question.
Okay.
If he's,
yeah, I don't. Again, I appreciate that.
I do not know who he is.
You don't know who he is, but you will in a few seconds.
So Lenny,
let me talk to you first. And I ask everybody the same question so you're aware of it. Do you know who Luana is? Are you aware of who she is? You are. Okay. And so did she invite you to class today or how did it come to be that you're here?
Why are you showing me that? Who's the guy that created Star Wars or
George Lucas?
George Lucas. Okay.
Well, there's a circuitous route there. Let's say George Lucas represents film. Let's just say that. Okay.
Right.
Yes. And there's the person that I've seen. Let's just go straight to the source. I want Lenny because I know I'm only got you for a few minutes, really.
but I know that there's a connection to it, but I don't know. I don't know what it is.
Lenny, that's all right. We'll get to it. So here's what I want to ask you, sir. Who greeted you on the flip side when you crossed over?
George Lucas.
Oh, so somebody like George Lucas, a filmmaker. Okay, very good. Somebody who looked like George, is that correct? Or somebody?
The guy, so it was the actor I'm being shown. It's not George Lucas, it's the actor, the old guy, the old guy. That doesn't even make sense. Hold on. I don't know if it was the father. Give me a second.
So somebody that wasn't in your immediate family.
I have this picture in my head and I don't know who it is. And it's one of the people in Star Wars, like the original Star Wars.
You mean like Alec Guinness? You mean like that, the actor who played Obi-Wan, the older guy? Or you mean somebody in Star Wars? Is that what? Well,
just move that aside. Let's push that aside.
Let's set that aside. Okay, we'll get back to it. So Lenny, so who greeted you? What was it like when you crossed over?
Parents. His parents greeted him. He also had, there was also an unborn child. And there was also somebody else that was a son or something like that greeted him too.
Was your wife nearby or around?
Yes. They were holding. Okay, so she came through with a baby.
Oh, so, she came through with a child that you didn't have. Okay. Yeah. All right, so let me just give you some background. So Lenny.
They were together like 48 years, it feels like.
Well, they were together for some time. I'm looking at my notes here. You had three children, Lenny, with your wife. Her name is Felicia. And what was that like for you when you saw Felicia for the first time on the flip side?
He cried. Like, it was the overjoyed. That was his soulmate. That was his everything, from what I'm picking up. Did she die from breast cancer or lung cancer?
She did die from lung cancer. That's correct. Or could have been breast cancer. I'm sorry. She died from cancer. But Lenny, I want to ask you a really important question. Who were you surprised to see on the flip side once you got over there?
I don't think I'm going to know who it is, but hold on.
I'm going to throw some names at you. Was his name Gustav? Is that correct? Have you seen Gustav?
Yes, many times, he said.
Many times. Okay. And show Jennifer what that was like. You saw Gustav. Here's a person who passed away a long time before you, but you spent your life.
We celebrated together, like all the accomplishments. He was so proud of me and everything, even though it wasn't like, not so, I don't want to say so, hold on.
Wow.
He showed me how I channeled music and how I was involved with music that came from him.
Like, that's correct. Now this is giving me a chill. I'm getting emotional about it. I'm sorry, but this is amazing. So let's speak some more, Lenny, about Gustav, your friend.
His whole life was predicated, it feels like, by Gustav. Part of, a major portion of his life, he's saying.
Okay, very good. All right, so we're going to get to the meat of this story in a second, which is to say, I was going to ask somebody a question the other day about you. And the question that I want to ask you is, and without Jennifer, knowing what I'm talking about, but maybe she'll get it. What did you think of the movie, Lenny?
Thrilled. A celebration.
Celebration. What was your favorite part? Now, I don't know if Jennifer's seen this movie.
The ending. I have no idea what you're talking about.
The editing was his favorite part?
The ending was his favorite.
The ending. Part. Oh, okay.
The ending. He said, it was such an enormous tribute, and it was such a magical, scene, it feels like.
If you wanted to say anything to the filmmaker, what would it be?
Thank you. And I love you. Thank you, and I love you.
The filmmaker said that you were on set. He could feel you on set.
I didn't miss one second of anything that was done.
Can you give us an example, or show Jennifer an example of a moment where you were on set? Now, Jennifer doesn't know what I'm talking about, that you were on set and you felt like you were.
He showed me Fred Astaire tap dancing for some reason. I have no idea why.
Dancing, correct?
Yes, dancing.
Okay. There is a scene where the music that he wrote, he's a composer, music that he wrote was used, and there was a dance scene, and you were there. Is that correct?
It says I was immersed in it. I wanted them to feel it. I wanted them to feel everything, because that was also one of my favorite parts, is the dancing and being one with the music, why you dance. And the love that was attributed with the music, why you dance. And then the way it brought people together. I have the chills so bad. I have no idea what we're talking about. This is amazing.
Well, this is why this is so powerful and emotional. Talk to us a little bit about your journey. So when you crossed over, were you a believer in the afterlife? Was this something you expected?
Not always. I could have never dreamt the welcoming home that I received.
Describe that to us. What was that like for you?
Stop.
What? Is that Billy slipping in there? What?
No. Who's our favorite talk show host over there?
Jimi Hendrix.
He was behind, like, I feel like he does all the reviews of people that come over. I don't know why that's so funny.
Well, but please describe what that was like. Listen, I understand what you're talking about. The audience may not. Jennifer does. We've had Jimi Hendrix come through so many times in so many different conversations. And that's why she said stop, because it's like, really, again? But Jimmy, whose life was cut short, shows up because everyone knows him, and he's a musician, and he loves to show up with musicians as well. So what was that like for you to see Jimi Hendrix on the flip side, please?
I said, okay, all right. He just started asking me questions.
And like, you know, what kind of questions did he ask you?
Are you done yet? Are you done from being over there? Like,
are you ready to come home?
Happy to be home. Are you ready to be home?
Wow.
And without speaking, the emotions of everyone that was around. And he felt the standing ovation that he received when he got there. It's challenging to express what I'm seeing, actually.
Go ahead, please. Just as best you can.
Like, every... hold on. He showed me like lights and lights and lights of people. Like, so if everybody came with a light, you know, all the different lights, like a huge, it's like being in a, I don't know, the only thing I can think of is Coldplay, you know, when you see all the different lights, or Taylor Swift, when all the lights are out in the audience. He's like, but each one of them has a direct, you know, feeling towards you. He's like, imagine that each person got to share the love that they had for you, and whatever I did for work and whoever, you know, whoever was there, he goes, it was just the unexpected love that you get from going over there is something that music actually is made out of when it comes from love.
You know, we've talked to a number of musicians in the book Tuning Into the Afterlife, and this fellow was one of those musicians, and a very sort of famous musician. And so what you're describing, this idea of being him coming out on stage and then seeing all the people that he connected to and was emotionally connected with, is so beautiful. I'm going to ask you a few people. Have you talked to them? You were friends with are any presidents stopped by to see you? Let me ask you that. Or people, or politicians type people?
I almost felt Ronald Reagan.
Well, interesting.
But then I go back to,
you know, if Jennifer knew who I was talking about and we had researched this, you know, she would immediately have that person in mind. So I'm going to ask you, have you run into JFK?
I just said Robert. I'm sorry.
Robert Kennedy. All right, very good. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you. So Robert Kennedy, yes, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. But he showed me Reagan, and then it went to Robert. And then it went to JFK.
JFK. So both Robert and John, this person.
They were very good friends.
They were good friends. And he was
important.
He was involved with composing the music for their funerals.
Wow.
And conducting the music. And it's, I obviously you have not seen this guy's story yet. But I wanted to ask you a question. It's a Beethoven question. We've talked to Beethoven before, and there is a famous moment when you conducted the Beethoven's Ninth, and when the Berlin Wall came down, and you changed the word Freude, which means joy, to Freiheit, which means freedom. Now, have you talked to Beethoven since you've been home?
Yes. He felt like he got a little slap on the face from it.
Because when they asked you about it, you said, I really feel like Beethoven would give his blessing. So clearly, not so much.
It was in tongue-in-cheek humor, but yes.
Like a gentle slap, and I got slapped in the face by Johnny Mathis because I told him that my mother was his biggest fan, and he literally whap, like just knocked the shit out of me. So I would also say, the film that we're talking about and the person that we're talking about is Leonard Bernstein, and the movie's called Maestro. And I was at the premiere the other night, and both Spielberg and Steven and Bradley talked about feeling your presence in the room.
My goodness, now it's all coming back. I had no idea. You know that.
I know that. Yeah, and you haven't. Have you seen the movie? No.
Oh, no, I think I might have seen a clip from.
Sure. Ask you. So now that we're clear who this is, Lenny, I want to know, have you talked to Robert Wise?
That's why he looked so crazy to me. He showed me being just a crazy musician.
He was a crazy musician.
But I also felt like he researched everything. He felt like a scientist to me too.
He was a genius, and he was a composer and a conductor and all these other things that he did. He introduced music, classical music, to television. He did a series for like years, you know, children's concert, young people's concerts. He did for decades. But I want to ask you about a couple of people, that you've run into. I mean, this thing about Mahler, he was famous for Gustave Mahler's music. He studied his whole life. He conducted his whole life. There's a sequence in the movie where he does Gustav Mahler's second. And so it's very powerful and emotional to hear that that was one of the people who came to see him.
Yeah. Well, they were so intertwined. I can't explain it. And I didn't know that.
Oh, I asked about Robert Wise. I don't know if you were friends with him. Were you? I don't know. I knew Robert.
They met. They
weren't close? That's okay. Doesn't matter.
We weren't close, but we are now.
Okay. Very good. I don't know if Robert remembers me, but he's the guy who directed West Side Story.
We had a lot of similar, he said they had a lot of similar stories.
So let me ask you, people would ask this question, what is your favorite piece? I know they asked you this in life, but was there a musical piece that's your own that you favored?
He showed me something with the Olympics. Is there anything that he did with the Olympics?
Well, he was very tight with Aaron Copland. They were very close. And I know Copland did the music for the Olympics.
Yeah, okay, cool. Okay.
So there, and he also did a concert for the opening of JFK's museum or the, I forget what it's called, in Washington, the JFK Center for Arts. And he composed something called Mass, which was a religious piece.
He loved that piece. He tried to take the religion out of it.
Yeah, and people say that. They say that, that's the controversy about that piece.
That's what he's telling me. He says that I liked this piece, but I liked it for its diversity, and I liked it without the religion part of it.
So who have you been surprised to see on the flip side, let's say, other than Jimmy?
Aretha Franklin.
Aretha. Okay, very good.
He said he knew her.
Would make sense, of course. They were two superstars in life.
Yeah. And he said that, the respect for her is beyond what he could have ever, you know, could have ever shown he the respect factor.
It's so fascinating. And she sang Nessun Dorma, you know, the Luciano Pavarotti song that he made so famous for the Grammys one year because Luciano was ill and he couldn't do it. And nobody knew what a classical artist she was. And we've spoken to Aretha about past life memory of being a opera singer.
Yeah.
What about you, Lenny? Was there anything in terms of your previous lifetimes you want to share or talk about or refer to?
It feels like he was Beethoven's father.
Wow. Well, we can ask Ludwig. Is that correct, or was it somebody that you appreciated?
Yeah, no. He's saying he was Beethoven's father.
Well, that's, oh, are you saying figuratively or literally, Lenny?
Literally.
Very interesting. We talked to Ludwig.
We can't prove it, but it.
No.
He's saying.
But we have talked to Beethoven about his life and his journey and how he lost his hearing and et cetera, et cetera. And I remember specifically, he talked to us about his happiest lifetime was as a farmer in the South Tyrol, I think he said, where the Black Forest, where he said the symphony was vegetables and corn and, you know, things, and he could control the symphony that way. And he was more happy because everything was sort of orderly and, you know, gave him joy, that word. Freude. It's a fascinating idea. Let me ask you a little bit about Felicia. So in the movie, they really dealt pretty much, and Jennifer hasn't seen it, but they dealt with her getting sick in her last days on the planet. Go ahead.
It felt like it was really brutal. Was there addiction somewhere in the storyline?
Cigarettes. Then clearly, I mean, the movie.
So then that's why he was showing me. It was him, not Norman. He just kept showing me cigarettes.
Smoking. Yeah, that's right. You're correct. I don't think there's a scene in the movie where he's not smoking a cigarette. But he also had emphysema late in life. And you know, for me, I guess I could ask you this, Lenny. Did your smoking influence the cancer that your wife got? Secondhand smoke?
It absolutely did.
So does Felicia want to say anything? Do you want to bring her forth? I mean, certainly.
Doesn't matter. Where we stand right now, that never mattered. Like that, it doesn't.
Yeah.
You know, if it wasn't going to be that, she's saying it would have been something else.
Okay. And what was your journey like? I'm sorry. You know, when you crossed over, who was there to greet you?
Well, that's what he showed me when he showed me our guy.
Okay. And two things that I want to mention about you, Felicia, and you, Lenny, and if you guys want to weigh in about it, but both of you were very social activists, both involved with anti-war protests. And in Felicia's case, she was somebody who was into criminal justice reform. And Lenny's case, he was a AIDS activist. Very powerful and strong and very adamant about those things. Is there anything they want to say about that? Or just their observation of how the planet is spiraling out of control now?
He's like, good luck. He's like, we did what we could. I'm kidding. He's like, we're still helping from the other side. That's what we do. There's a chance for us to help heal the planet. If enough people believe in that, it's not too late. It's never too late. It just feels like it with the direction that we're going. People are a lot more open-minded now to understanding what we're doing and how there isn't really any time for more hate or more, you know, separation. We need to be more. We need more unity. We need more oneness. We need more wholeness, more peace, more love.
More wholeness, more peace, and this separation of humans. It's so powerful when you mentioned what Lenny's observation was coming on stage and seeing how we're all connected, as well as the love towards him. And when we get off stage, we see that these wars that we're doing, we're fighting, and these wars and this kind of bickering and constant sniping at each other is ridiculous. Or it's just
there's no time for that anymore. There's no time for the nitpicking or the debating just to get an agenda across.
It's kind of it seems pointless when you look at it from their perspective. But let me ask you this, Lenny. I'd be, you know, remiss if I didn't ask you, out of the music that you know, and then let's say the composers that you know, who do you recommend? Oh, by the way, you also when you first did Carnegie Hall, you did a piece. Go ahead.
Show me Sting.
Sting. Listen to Sting. I like that. That's very good. Yeah. Oh, very good. Gordon Sumner. That's his original name. Because I was a music critic at Variety some years ago and got to meet Sting and whatever. Sting's a good example of a guy who meditates and does music. Robert Schumann. Schumann was the first concert that Lenny Bernstein was able to do was at Carnegie Hall. And the first thing that he did it unrehearsed was with a composer named Robert Schumann's piece. Have you talked to Schumann on the other side?
Still trying to find him. Hold on. Yeah, he's talked to him.
And go ahead.
She says he wasn't impressed.
He was not impressed.
Hold on.
That's pretty interesting.
No, the other guy said that he wasn't impressed with him coming for Carnegie Hall at the time that they booked.
The Mahler character, Gustav?
No. The guy that. So when they're at Carnegie Hall, you said that he did something at Carnegie Hall?
Well, what happened was Bruno Walter was the, you know, the conductor at Carnegie Hall, and he got sick. So they had to have Lenny come in and substitute for him. So he might not have been impressed. He was not impressed. But the rest of the country suddenly heard his name, and it went out live. Just interesting because Schumann was a composer who heard angels. That's what he said when he wrote. He could hear the music coming from the other side. And his wife reported that to somebody who then had him, you know, put in a mental institution because he was hearing music from the other side. And he ended up dying in a mental institution, you know.
Oh.
That is awful. But I was just curious if you've talked to him or what, you know. You've had any conversations with Robert?
They have. He's shown me like a circle of like how everything worked out for both of them and how I get like one person couldn't have done without the other kind of thing. It's interesting how connected they are in a lot of ways. He says he heard a lot of things, but never said it out loud.
Yeah. Listen, there's a 6.5 minute piece inside the movie Maestro where Bradley Cooper imitates you, but like embodies you doing conducting Mahler's Second Symphony in a church in England. And it is just an astounding achievement in filmmaking. It's all one take. It's just amazing. And they did it like on the second day of shooting, and it was just one take. And you can watch it on YouTube, from the Maestro, but you can actually watch his original performance. Is there any piece that you would recommend that people listen to try to access their loved ones on the other side, like as if the music could help put them in that state of mind?
You said Mass.
Okay. Well, would it be a way to contact you?
That too.
Okay.
Unless you're listening to this, people don't know that I'm available, which I am.
Unless people are tuning into Hacking the Afterlife podcast, they're not aware that Leonard Bernstein is available. So let me just paraphrase what you're saying, sir, which is take out a photograph of Leonard, put it up in your room, maybe the album cover, put on the album or the music from Mass, and ask him to help you, talk to your loved ones?
Loved ones, or just listen to the music and talk to them direct.
So don't have to look at Leonard, look at your relative, perhaps. Bring out a photograph of the loved one you want to speak to. Okay, you're tapping your nose for people driving their car, meaning correct, and listen to mass.
Right.
And then ask them questions about their journey, or, you know, to help intercede, or whatever it is that you need to have them, you know, communicate with you about. I think this is so fascinating, because here we have also have Norman Lear, one of the most prolific. I'm sorry, I didn't tell you his last name. Norman, we'll talk to him later on.
Okay. Because then, listen, anybody that knows me, I don't want, don't front load the medium. Don't give her information. Just give me,
I want to point out how polite he was to say, talk to Lenny, because he's been here longer. And so Norman can come and talk to us at any time, you know, and because he just left the stage recently. So in this way, say again.
That's what they said. They're like, there's somebody, you know, Norman left the planet. It just left the planet.
Crazy smoking dude. Talk to him first. That's right.
And I didn't know that was Norman.
No, but I have a whole list or a raft of questions for Norman to talk about his life and his journey, but we will do that in another time. I just felt it was so important to hear. And, you know, thank you, Jennifer, for allowing me to sort of not give you all the information, but let you come to it.
That's what I love doing, is my work, trying to figure out the puzzle pieces. But you've given me a space not to fear it and not to judge it. So even when I don't get the right interpretation, I just have to go back in. They're not wrong. I just might, you know, be looking at the wrong person over there, like I did thinking Norma was a smoker.
That's right. Well, Lenny, let's let you have the last word. Anything you want to say to Bradley or Steven Spielberg?
He just went like this. He just did like a bow.
Very low bow. His bows were very low. They're pretty amazing.
Yeah. I don't know. But yeah, he did that for them.
Like from the waist all the way down. Amazing. So a bow to him. Well, I guess, you know, one day Bradley will be on the flip side. You guys can commiserate and talk about how cool that was.
Or maybe I'll talk to Bradley.
That's right. Then maybe Bradley will call Jennifer up to see if he can have a conversation directly with. Have you ever shown up at Bradley's house or talked to him that way?
His dreams all the time.
Yeah, all the time in dreams. Okay. Thank you so much, Jennifer. Thank you for your gifts. Thank you. I think the time is right. Yes, it is. Okay. And thank you, Leonard Bernstein. Oh my gosh. How cool was that?
That was really cool. I can't wait to watch the movie now. I can't wait to look up what's going on.
Got to see the movie. It is fantastic. You really will get a kick. You'll get everything out of it. I mean, it's so complex and it's so much about Felicia as well. And thank you, Felicia, for coming by to chat with us as well. And I know your children are still on the planet, and I'm sure if they stumble upon this, they'll be hopefully chuffed to hear that Dad was around to applaud them.
Yep.
Thanks so much.
Bye.
Love, love. Bye-bye.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife Podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Amazon Prime.